Outnumbering every species on Earth by the billions, arthropods are the most successful phylum ever formed by evolution. Characteristic jointed legs and exoskeleton, they are not surprisingly advantageous. I mean, they literally are born with their own body armor. This is one of our three-part invertebrate dissection series, this time featuring the creepy crawlies, grasshoppers. We'll start off with identifying the directionality and also the outer portions of the grasshopper. Facing me here, of course, is the dorsal backside of the grasshopper. Majority of the wings are usually attached here. And then by turning this over, we reveal the belly ventral side. So most of the legs are here on that ventral side. When we're flipping this over to the sideways, we should be able to see, of course, the two sides representing the anterior head portion right here, as well as the posterior tail portion on the back. You'll likely notice that the body is divided into three jointed parts. The first is the head region. One of the greatest advantages formed by evolution was the cephalization process, which is a fancy way of saying head formation. Arthropods were among the first animals to place their sensory organs in the front, including, of course, the compound eyes, the antenna, and mouth. This allowed for better hunting and movement, which was a major development millions of years ago. The middle joint here is the thorax, or the chest region of the grasshopper. It's formed by a tough carapace that overlaps the wing muscles and the front legs. And lastly is the abdomen, consisting of the remainder of the body and the organs. From here, you should be able to pry open the two wing layers. The first tough wing is the protective cover wing. These are, appropriately named, used to slide over and protect the fragile flight wings that are found right underneath. It looks like my grasshopper wasn't fully adult yet, so it looks like its wings are still kind of small. And of course, we can't forget the famous legs that gave grasshoppers their name. Notice how dominant these hind legs are, as they're used primarily for movement, escape, and even mating calls. If you brush your needle probe along the ends of the hind legs, you can almost mimic the vibrations you would hear as they brush them across their wings for those famous cricket chirps that you hear at night. Now, if you have a female like I do, you should notice that at the end of the posterior region is an obvious structure called an ovipositor, which is an opening in which the eggs are laid. I'll start by cutting away the legs to give me a little bit more room during the dissection process. Here, I'm using the scissors to cut right at the base of each leg. Alternatively, you can also use your hands to twist and pull them off, but be careful not to damage the interior organs along the way. As you're cutting away the legs, you might notice the defining characteristic of arthropods. Arthropods are defined as having an exoskeleton with jointed appendages. Arthro means joint, like arthritis, and pods means legs or feet. Grasshoppers specifically belong to a subphylum within the arthropods called hexapods, aka the insects, which basically adds on one characteristic of having six of those jointed appendages. This is why eight-legged spiders are considered arthropods, but are not considered insects. I've also taken the chance to cut off the wing layers from both sides. After doing this, you should be able to notice a small circle that was underneath all the wings the entire time. This is called the tympanic membrane, otherwise known as the ears of the insect. As the noises are sensed, they vibrate these membranes like a drum, and then they send signals to the brain. With the hind legs off, I can also place them under a dissecting scope to really appreciate the spikes that make the famous cricket chirps. Moving higher up on the hind leg, you can even see the exoskeleton that leaves almost no weak points, even up to the joints that give arthropods their name. Weak point is relative to the predator, of course. Now that the obstacles are out of the way, we can begin our dissection process. I'm going to grab my scissors to make a small incision at the posterior overpositor. From there, I'm going to make small snips along the dorsal exoskeleton, through the abdomen, and even past the thorax. I'll stop once I reach the back of the head. As a small tip, keeping the blade of your scissors parallel to the exoskeleton will allow you to cut further up without actually tearing the internal organs along the way. Because the tough exoskeleton isn't flexible enough to open, it can sometimes help to make lateral incisions like I'm doing here across the neck. After doing so, and with the help of some forceps, this should help open the carapace more easily for your dissecting pins. I'll be pinning down the thorax first, as it's the heaviest piece. Placing the pins at an angle will help you give more room as you work. When I get down to the abdomen, I'll use my needle probe and my pins as you see here to pry them open, placing about maybe 2 pins on each side. As you pry open the exoskeleton down by the thorax, you may notice some fibers that are attached from the exoskeleton into the interior organs. Be very careful not to disturb or tear these fibers, because they're actually very important, and we'll talk about these in a little bit. Now it looks like I'm just about to be done here, but remember of course that patience is key to make sure you have a clean dissection. Let's talk about some of the things that we see. I've zoomed up to reveal those fibers that I mentioned earlier. As I roll over the main organs, you'll notice these fibers connecting to all the organs to the inner wall of the exoskeleton. They're found on both sides like this. These fibers are called trachea, which are actually the main respiratory organ of insects. The evolution of flight is immensely energy costly, which means that the periodic breathing that we see in humans is too slow. Insects have actually evolved their own air intake system to directly feed their bodies with oxygen during flight. Insects essentially evolved their own air intake engines like we see in muscle cars. Now, since mine was a female, the obvious overlaying structures on top like you see here are the ovaries. During reproduction, these ovaries will form hundreds of eggs. With my needle probe and forceps, you can kind of poke apart these ovaries into two halves, and also see that they are, not surprisingly, connected to the ovipositor below. Once again, to make more room for observations, I'm going to peel back and remove the ovaries by severing the connection to the ovipositor with some scalpel and scissors. With the ovaries out of the way, we should be able to see more clearly the digestive organs located below. When I peel the head forward with my needle probe like this, I can see this kind of esophagus which is leading directly into the digestive canal. Right after the esophagus, just posterior of the head, is the crop. Similar to our friends in the annelids, the earthworms, grasshoppers have a storage pouch for food in preparation for digestion. Just below the crop are actually these finger-like projections on top called gastric ceca. They're the main secretion gland for digestion, releasing important things like digestive enzymes and even containing friendly bacteria used to break down tough fibers that grasshoppers eat. Now, just past the gastric ceca is kind of this weird amalgamation tube of organs that is both the stomach and the intestines. Together, they're used to digest and absorb nutrients. This mass of fibers near the posterior end is called the Malpighian tubules. They're sort of deflated from the dissection process, but they basically function kind of like kidneys, removing wastes from the body. We'll be able to see the last few structures by rolling over the main internal organs. As you're doing this, you might be able to see more of those tracheal tubes as they become more obvious. No worries on trying to keep these pristine now, feel free to tear them off as you roll over these organs. To fully peel back the digestive tract, I'm going to use scissors to cut the connection of the esophagus by pushing the head forward and making a small incision. After doing so, you should be able to easily peel back the entire digestive tract, revealing the interior of that ventral exoskeleton. Throughout this dissection, you probably noticed that there weren't any obvious veins or arteries. Arthropods do have hearts, but they pump their version of blood called hemolymph into the open crevices of their body without the need of any vessels. It's a very low-cost body fluid system for those with small bodies encased in a shell like arthropods, not so great for larger animals like mammals. As a bonus, I'm going to cut a sliver of the compound eye of this grasshopper and place it under a slide in a microscope. Here you can see all the hexagon shapes that make up the compound eye of insects. This multiple bubble view gives insects the ability to see a wider range of their surroundings, just another adaptation that has allowed hexapods to be a dominant force on Earth. From breathing, digestion, and vision, it's always kind of cool to see how animals each have evolved their own solutions to life. Go ahead and biohazard your specimens and check out the other videos in this invertebrate dissection series.